everybody's here as we talk about really important information as we begin to think about what it looks like to reopen our buildings for continued ministry. So I'm going to offer the platform right now to Bishop McKee, but before I do that, I just want to remind you that you can go up to your right-hand corner and take a opportunity to do speaker view or grid view, however you like to participate. And that sometimes can help your experience if you've got the right view. And we'll also be having the presentation and the resources in the chat box so that you can cut and paste the links and have resources for yourself. And then you can also ask questions in the chat as we continue to meet for the next 90 minutes. So I'll pass everything on over to Bishop McKee, and we'll move forward. So I present to you Bishop Mike McKee.
Thank you, Cammy. So I want to thank you all for being on the call today. And I know that some of us are reaching Zoom fatigue, but we will not grow weary in our well-doing. I want you to know that, but I appreciate you being on. And I think that we can be helpful to many of you, and we have some people who can be helpful that also are planning to present from perspectives that, on which they're working. I want to acknowledge for all of you that basically the churches in the East District, Northwest District, using proper guidelines that we have used as a conference, are on. They have opened their churches for the most part. But as we open, one of the things I want to remind you is that we will continue to keep the guidelines in place, which means that it's going to be challenging and difficult for some of you in larger congregations, especially about where do how many people can we have. And I remember, I think it was Christchurch, I think, Kim, y'all did a measuring, and it's not like what's 25% of the capacity. It's like what's 6 feet of equal distancing, social distancing around. So it's important to remember that. Also want to remind you that I think that there's a tendency that you get a lot of pushback on something like this. So I want to say to you that what's guided us as an annual conference has been my some mantra all along, is to just focus on especially the general rules in this way: do good, do no harm, and stay in love with God. And so especially on that do no harm, one of the things that has been my goal all along for all of us for this desired outcome is, number one, is I didn't want our clergy and their families to be at risk in contracting COVID-19 because of this, which means that the protocols are designed to lessen that risk. Secondly, I didn't want laity to also be at risk if they came to worship God. And the experience will not be like what they had, but it'll be different, but it'll be the way for people to gather. And we want people to know that they have to socially distance. I think about the church in this way. I know this has been very different, and I will tell you that I think it will continue to be different. And I will not be surprised if later this year we close churches again, if the virus ticks back up. And so I think it's important for us all to understand that. And one of the reasons why I've been reticent about this is the day we're going back, because early March, when the first time we closed, or the middle of March, I thought by the middle of April we would be open. And then, so I just did this month by month by month. It was guided primarily, I want to be honest with you, by the numbers. I think the numbers tell no lies, and they tell us how many people, how many new cases there are. The challenge, a little short rise in Collin and Denton counties recently, we believe we can open with some safety. But when it comes to Dallas County, we still don't know when that is, but we're having a meeting next week, either Monday or Tuesday. I can't remember, Deborah, Monday or Tuesday, with the Metro District pastors on.
We just said it and nobody knows it yet. It's Monday at 2.
Monday at 2 with them. So we'll be using the protocols, and we're asking that people continue to mask. I had a very interesting comment from one of our pastors yesterday when there was some pushback about masks, that it's not comfortable. They don't want to go to church and sing through a mask. The whole music thing is probably going to get addressed today. But what a mask does is it does not protect the wearer. It protects everybody else. And I think when you get to think about it, if everybody is wearing a mask, then everyone is welcome. That means a person who has a condition that really puts them at risk, I can go. Everybody's going to be wearing a mask. It means people over a certain age can feel more comfortable about going. Everybody's going to be wearing a mask. And so to be the beloved community and the church that we are, everybody should wear a mask. And I don't like wearing them either, but I tell you what, I do not want to infect anybody. I don't want to get it, but I don't want to do any harm by infecting anybody. I've had a COVID-19 test because of all the board members at Methodist Hospital were able to get one. I'm negative. Joan's negative. I want to stay that way, but I want our people to stay that way. I know this is going to be a challenging, difficult time, and we're still in conversation about when those churches, the Metro District, were open, but I think you're going to get a lot of good content today. It'll be very helpful, and the challenge is going to be about how do you tell someone, you got to wear a mask, you got to stay 6 feet apart. We don't have room for you, but you can go here and watch on TV or any number of things. But I know this is hard work and blessings on doing this, but there's a goal, and the goal is that no church be a petri dish for COVID-19, and that we want everyone to feel safe in our buildings. No matter when we're together, we want everyone to be safe from the spread of the virus. This is not a hoax. The virus is real. And I was just talking to Joelle, and evidently, I think someone in Fort Worth has contracted the virus for the second time, they think. So, blessings on your time together. I know that you have a good call. I will say that Cammy and other people who joined her in this effort are very adept. It's what is permitted and what to do and how to do it. And I want to thank the annual conference team, especially, and some other people they've gathered around them for working on this. And blessings on you. And because I'm really moving for executive platinum now in Zoom miles, and I'm going to get off this call so I can get some more Zoom miles, since this qualifies as one call. But we've all learned to live with this, and it's just the way it is, isn't it? So blessings on what you do. Thank you, Cammy.
Thank you, Bishop.
I'm sure I'll be on another call with you at some point.
All right. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
So the purpose of today's webinar is to focus on the large church. And I'm assuming that if you're a part of a medium-sized church and small church, you can also gain a lot of information from today's presenters. We're going to be discussing what it means to be a pastoral leader in these times, as well as a lot of details that have to do with opening our buildings for continual ministry in our churches. So for your knowledge, today the presenters will be Reverend Kay Eck, who is from Lovers Lane United Methodist Church. We will also have Lynnita Jessen, who is from First United Methodist Church of Richardson. Kay Richardson is with us, and she will be speaking to us from St. Andrew United Methodist Church. I think I noticed that her name was Robert Hasley on there, but she is really Kay Richardson and a great resource. And Kim Hill is also with us from Christ United Methodist Church of Plano. Our district superintendents and center directors will also be facilitating breakout rooms along with these leaders. So all of these persons will be assisting us in our presentation. I also have some information that I'm going to offer you from Reverend Don Underwood that was very insightful. And so we look forward to just gathering and giving you all this information. The first about 40 minutes, we will be going through a lot of details. And then the last 40, 45 minutes, we will be putting you into groups. There's about 115 people on this call. We were going to divide into 10 groups. So you'll have an opportunity to offer your insights and ask your questions in group. So that is that's the plan for today. So I will begin by just giving you the topics. The first part is we're going to have a small conversation on what it means to be a faithful leader and see the work we're doing with reopening buildings as a faith movement and a leadership opportunity to express your theology and your scriptural grounding in your practice. Then we're going to move to the context and challenges that we face, and so our contextual realities. We're going to step through a checklist so that you can look and see what some of our larger churches' checklists look like and what yours might look like. Next is the stages and rolling out of a plan. And sometimes we'll have to roll back into that stage if some things happen. So just to be aware of how much leadership is needed to just take a look at the things that are going on. And then we'll be looking at the larger picture of who the church is right now, all the different audiences that your church, ways your church looks. So, you know, some of your churches are going to be meeting online. Some of them are going to be meeting in person. And so it's going to look very different. And then last, we'll come back together to ask and answer questions. So that's our plan. And with that, and we'll just start our PowerPoint. With that, I would like to jump over to Todd Harris, who I would love for him to share a little bit about what it looks like. Let's go back. before I jump to Todd, there's a new resource out that is very well done. It's called Resuming Care-Filled Worship and Sacred Life During a Pandemic. And this is going to be placed in the chat so that you can copy and paste it. But it will cover most everything that we have discussed today. We'll also have the PowerPoint that you can, as I said, download. But this one particularly, I think, will be very helpful for your use. So, and with that said, one of the things I like about this particular resource is that it has a very strong theological undergirding as well as biblical leadings for us in this time as a way of really caring for our people and our churches and the communities that we live in and honoring their sacred worth. And so I think it's very helpful in the work that we're going to be doing together. So, all right. Todd Harris, if you would just take a few minutes to talk a little bit about setting the table for pastoral leadership and how it is that the shepherd has become your guiding metaphor as you've thought about reopening our buildings.
Oh, thank you, Cammy. And Cammy, thank you for guiding us in this process to always ground ourselves theologically in what we do. Whether you're a pastor or a lay leader or another type of leader in your church on staff, we are grounded in our faith, and our faith should be our guide in all processes, especially major processes such as this. And so I appreciate Cammy encouraging us to do that. You know, we all have different parts of the Bible, different images that resonate with us throughout our life, and at different times, different seasons. And being a pastor or being a lay leader, there are different parts of the Bible that truly speak to us and that we resonate with, that begin to serve as a guide. And for me, one of those images in the Bible that has been an image that I've long resonated with, and that's the image of the shepherd. And so even as I pastored a church, I resonated with the image of the shepherd and all that perhaps brings to mind as I think about what it means to pastor a congregation. And then even as a district superintendent now, one of the images that I remember thinking about when we were challenged to do this back at DS Training School, again, I resonated with the image of the shepherd and what that means in terms of leading a flock of churches. And so for me, there is no doubt that Christ is the good shepherd. So Christ is the ultimate shepherd that guides us in our work and our ministry. And then the bishop is also a shepherd that guides and directs our annual conference and the cabinet. But as a district superintendent, as a leader in the conference, as a leader in the district, I resonate with this image of the shepherd and all that brings to mind. And so the shepherd leads, the shepherd sometimes guides, the shepherd sometimes stands in the middle of the flock, sometimes behind the flock, but the role of the shepherd is to lead, to guide. Sometimes we prod. Sometimes we have to go after the lone sheep to bring them back into the flock. I know I've had multiple conversations with pastors that I've, one reason or another, haven't had recent contact with. And so I like to reach out to them and say, hey, come and be a part of the flock. And let's realize that what we're doing is all together. So sometimes I have to go after the ones that have gone astray and lead them back to the flock. One of the things that recognized either in the local church, and both in the local church and as a district superintendent, is that sometimes the sheep want to do what they want to do. and sometimes we call that stubbornness, strong-willed. And so part of my work is to help cultivate that relationship so that they're able to catch a glimpse of the vision. The bishop talked about, you know, a desire to keep all of our pastors and their families safe in this time. And I can't tell you how many times I've heard that. He is committed to keeping our pastors and their families safe from the virus. He's committed to keeping our churches safe. And so that's a vision that he has instilled in our minds as we consider the process of resuming in-person worship. So sometimes sheep want to do their own thing, and perhaps you experience that in your local church, and what's your role in that? So anyway, that's an image that I resonate with, that helps to ground me theologically, that reminds me of the work that I do and the variations of the ways in which I live that out in my role now as a district superintendent. And all this is to say is to just to challenge you, and we're going to have time in our small group meetings in just a moment, to consider what is it that grounds you theologically? Maybe your image is being a neighbor. Maybe your image is another one that we find in some other one that we find in the Bible, but what is it that grounds you theologically that will guide you in the process of resuming in-person worship? That's where we're going with this, because I believe when we're grounded theologically, we're able to differentiate ourselves, to self-differentiate ourselves as followers of Jesus Christ, and we're able to stand there and be a non-anxious presence as we guide our church. So what image resonates with you and your soul and guides you, especially in this process? So that's all I have to say about that, Cammy.
Thank you. I appreciate that. So on a regular basis, Todd has been one of those persons that has been a great conversation partner with me and with our cabinet about why we do things theologically and grounding ourselves biblically. So I really appreciate your words. Thank you so much. We're going to move next to KEC. And early on, Lovers Lane did a really good survey, found out all kinds of interesting pieces of content that helped them guide what their next steps were going to be. Some of our larger churches have also done surveys. I think some of our smaller ones as well. And the ones that people that are presenting today have given Kay some of the feedback that they've gotten. And so she's going to share right now some of the context challenges and realities and survey information that she's come up with. Okay.
Hi, friends. It is really great to see you all. This is my little sheep, Ellie, who wants to do whatever she wants to do right now when she's supposed to be taking a nap. So I apologize for that. But when considering your context of ministry, we really suggest that you send a survey to your congregation just to get their feedback and find out where they are. And I know that many of you have already done this, But we would be happy to share our survey questions with you and the survey questions gathered from some of the other large churches who are presenting today. If you sent a survey several weeks ago, you might consider sending one again to your congregation, as people seem to be kind of changing where they stand on how they feel about what's going on. But across the board from the surveys that I looked at, we ask really similar questions like, which service did you attend online? What was your experience of that service? Did you experience God in a way at that service? We ask for people's age. What precautions would you need to be in place for you to come back to worship? Would you bring a child or someone in a high-risk category to worship with you? And overall, it really seemed that those with younger children and those who are in a higher risk category were not ready to return to campus yet, quite yet. But interestingly, those with youth group age students, especially those who are in sports, are ready to come back as soon as they can. Some consistent precautions that people seem to expect are to have hand sanitizers available, the wearing of face masks, designated ingress and egress areas with clearly marked paths on the floor, eliminating any handshakes or greeting times, and eliminating congregational singing. It sounds like most people are monitoring the coronavirus cases close to them in their area, and that's the primary determining factor in when people feel comfortable returning to our campuses. So we've also found that most of our classes and groups have transitioned to being online very easily, and they really like that. We've even gotten some feedback that some prefer to keep the Zoom option online so they don't have to get in the car and drive to class or to their groups during the week. So as you're considering your context, continue to think about how we can do no harm and how you can continue to reach your online audience, even as you prepare to come back to in-person worship. We believe we'll see a significant decrease in the number of people who physically attend our campus when we do open. So we've tried to be intentional about thinking about how do we continue to address online audience as well as the in-person audience. And we've kind of talked about it like this. Like pre-COVID, we did worship services online with the people online kind of looking over our shoulder into what was happening in the room. Post-COVID, we have to switch that thinking to we're worshiping online, and as people come back, we let them look over our shoulder into the production of what's going on. So we'd be happy to share our surveys with you and some of those results, and I encourage you to send one just to figure out where your people are and what they're expecting.
So Kay, one of the things that you said to us early on was that you were surprised to find out how many folks responded positively to the online experience. Would you just say a couple words about that?
Sure. On the Lover's Lane survey, we ask specifically, how have you experienced God? Have you experienced God in the same way or more with worshiping online or less? And we found that about 75% of the people said that they experienced God in the same way or more than they had previously. And so that was really encouraging for us to continue to do really good online worship.
All right. Well, thank you, Kay. And I appreciate the highlights that you brought with us and showed us today. And she does have all of those, her survey available, as well as some other options if you want to connect with her. All right. Our next presenter is Kim Hill, and she's going to be talking about a checklist for reopening.
Hi, everyone. I'm glad to have this opportunity to share some of the work we've been doing at Christ United. First of all, I want to say that there's unfortunately no single checklist that's going to work for everyone. So I am kind of giving you a broad brush of what you should be thinking about as you decide to reopen. The first thing is to create a task force that's focused on strategy and procedure. So you need to decide who you want on that task force, facilities person for sure, probably hospitality, engagement, communications definitely. age level ministries, because it's not just about opening worship, it's about when to open everything. And then decide how you want to, or if you want to, or when you want to, involve lay committees, lay members in that process. So right now we meet, and we have been for a long time, we meet every week for at least a couple hours to talk about all the reopening issues. Next, you'll want to, if you have members who are working in the medical profession, they're really helpful. It's good to kind of talk to them regularly and see where they are. They're a great resource for determining timing and policies. And then Kay just talked about surveys, and that surveys have been really helpful for us. We did our segmented, you know, we did demographics, and we found the same thing that Lover's Lane did, that the older demographic and the younger with children aren't ready to come back yet. And I'm happy to share that survey with anyone who would like it. And you may want to consider doing surveying more than once, because now we're into this almost 4 months. And as we all know, it's a pretty fluid situation. So opinions change throughout. Then you want to do research. So we've actually had someone go to a couple of larger churches on Sunday that are already open, not Methodist churches, and walk through the whole Sunday morning process. And that's been pretty enlightening. Gives you a lot of insight into what you probably do want to do and maybe what you don't want to do. And there's lots of opportunity for that. And then later on, you'll hear from Kay Richardson about communicating. And it's just vital that throughout this process, you regularly communicate what you're doing as a staff to get to reopen. Because, you know, your congregation is wondering when, how, if, so it's important to do that. The next piece is phasing. And, you know, to me, that's almost the most difficult piece to come up with. It's a kind of a logistical nightmare. Lynnita is going to go through First Richardson's phasing. But, you know, you have to consider all the different groups. You know, you've got staff and small groups, mission work, childcare, preschool, Sunday school, weddings, memorial services, just facilities rental, your gym if you have one, and worship. And all of those may or may not be phased in at different times. And then you have to define your parameters for reopening all those phases or all those groups. Is it the number of cases? You know, where do you start? Do you start with worship? Do you start with the groups? And then identify factors that would result in you closing after you've opened. Beyond, you know, the bishop saying we have to close, you may have other factors you want to consider. And then going to worship, which is, next slide is worship. The determining a worship style. So for a lot of us, for almost 4 months, we've really been, you know, refining our worship experience. We haven't been, you know, live for an hour in a long time. You know, we get to do multiple takes, lots of editing. We're having some offsite fun this month. And so would you suddenly go back to the usual 1 hour live for, I don't know, 100, 200 people, and you still have 1,000 plus online expecting what they've been receiving for the last 4 months? Do you do a hybrid? Do you do both? So there has to be a really big conversation about that for sure. Calculating your worship capacity. It's not as easy as it sounds, you know. You put the 36 square feet around every individual because most people don't come into the worship space as individuals. So you'll have, you know, families of four, families of two. So you're going to have probably a wide-ranging number. So we can seat, our capacity is about 1,800, but from our calculations, it would be 200 to 300, depending on size of family units. So you need to make that calculation. We've talked about a reservation system just for headcount. You wouldn't actually have people, you know, show their ticket or their phone or whatever when they come to services. But it would give you a good idea of headcount. And if you're getting close to what capacity is, then you have to decide if you're going to, you know, close the reservation system. What I found in looking at other churches and talking to people who have been going to church, that doesn't look like it's going to be a problem. Most people aren't getting close to their capacity, even their reduced capacity. And then you have to talk about multiple services. For our sanctuary, it will take us an hour and a half to clean the whole sanctuary. So we'll need that much time between services if we decide to do multiple services. Maybe you go in slower and do one service to begin with, and just wait for that, because it's you know, that's a lot of work to have to clean that quickly. Singing, that's a whole nother issue, and I know y'all had a whole webinar on that, so gonna have to decide if the congregation singing, if people on the chancel are singing, communion, got to decide how you might want to do that. Mask, we are planning to require mask for worship. And how are you going to manage that? You're going to have to decide who will be the person or the people that will confront people in the sanctuary when they've decided to take their mask off. We have signs up right now that say, love your neighbor, wear a mask. So it's just that's going to be a difficult piece of it. And, you know, how do you do communion with a mask on is another issue. Do you manage the parking lot? Then you've got to think about ingress and egress. How many doors do you have open? Do you dismiss by rows? Restrooms. We visited one church that had their restrooms closed. So, which might not be a great idea. But if you have your restroom open, you have to have attendants in the restroom, because they have to clean after every person that's in there. And then really importantly is managing expectations, because the people that will come, the last time they were in your sanctuary, things will have looked a whole lot different, especially if you're going to be doing showing a live stream on the screens. And then to prepare, you have to develop your Sunday morning policies and procedures. That's going to be a long list. So it's all about seating and how you shepherd people through the building to keep them distance, long list. Now you got to start recruiting and training so you'll be prepared. And you need staff and volunteer participation guidelines, a facilities hygiene protocol. Your facilities use policies need to be amended to account for COVID and all the things that need to be done with that. The tracing system, it's not something you're required to do, but it seems like it would be the right thing to do to know who's in the building on Sunday morning. I mean, we know who's in the building all week long, so we can trace that way. But on a Sunday morning, how will you do that? You don't want pens that everyone's signing in. You can use an app and have them do it that way. You don't want them punching it in on the screen. You need to revise your waivers if you haven't already done that. No, we won't have Sunday morning worshipers sign waivers, but we do have anyone participating in mission work definitely signing waivers that contains the new COVID information. And then signage. So your communications team is going to be busy creating signage that does all the usual, you know, check and make sure you don't have a temperature, you don't, you know, have the symptoms, you haven't been around somebody. Wash your hands. I mean, just there's so much signage that has to be done. So I think I've gone way over my 5 minutes. It's a lot of information.
Thank you so much, Cam. I appreciate it. I mean, that slide is made available to you as to the group as well. Our next presenter is Lynnita. And she is from First United Methodist Church of Richardson. She's going to be talking about stages and rolling out a plan.
Well, thank you, Cammy. This is so much information. as you all will see. So moving into the phases, as Kim mentioned, putting together a logistics team is really important. And we did it very purposefully, making sure that all areas of the church were represented and all demographics, so different ages and life stages, so that we had all voices heard. And then determining how you are going to move forward, as Kim mentioned, is really important. What are going to be the determining factors that will move you from step one to step two? For FUMCR, we've decided to be more data-driven and not date-driven, and we're not going to move forward until we've seen flattened or declining numbers in Dallas County. So we started with step zero, which is the buildings closed. It was when we're shelter in place, and we tried to list all the major items that will need to be looked at from step to step. And we chose to do it based on gathering size. So the governor and the CDC, the guidelines from the beginning were gathering size. So we are currently in step one, transitioning to step two, but we are only allowing outside meetings, and those are, people are scheduling our, reserving our parking lot. So that's socially distanced with masks. We've had drive-through parades. We've had outdoor baptisms. Confirmation, our confirmands were baptized outside with lots of creativity. Our senior pastor used a palm branch to baptize our confirmands, so he was able to be socially distanced and far apart. We do not have staff on campus yet. It's all essential staff only. And then our school, we have an on-site school that was scheduled to open yesterday, but even our government facilities are not in agreement of how things should work. So we have the Texas Health and Human Services that had given us permission to open, because we, sorry, let me back up. We had teacher training and a case, someone tested positive just or had symptoms and had to self-quarantine immediately following teacher training last week. Texas Health and Human Services gave us permission to open on the 15th. The Dallas County Department of Health said everyone had to self-quarantine, and so our school opening was pushed off an additional week. But we're following all of the guidelines of the temperature checks and reduced class sizes and additional cleaning, all of that. Then our staff is not on campus yet. We're slowly doing that. We have our welcome desk manned just beginning this week for deliveries only, and essential staff are coming in. But that, all of those guidelines will be put into place as people enter the building. They're forced to go to only one door, temperature checks, masks, cleaning, all of that. So then we can move on to step two. That is 25 people. We're just moving forward so cautiously. Our preschool is closed for the summer, and it would not open until the fall anyways. It follows RISD. So staff and volunteers on campus, we're just saying approval required, socially distanced by appointment. So we're not letting anyone into our facility yet. We have a building across the street. So the first group, we wanted to support our support groups like AA. So they are the first group to be able to meet. We're requiring attendance be taken so that we'll know who's on campus. It will be kept confidential, but we're asking for them to follow all of the guidelines. So whoever is the person in charge of the group, they have to take that responsibility for the group to be meeting all of the requirements. Outside organizations, still just outside. Vehicle usage, we don't know when our buses and golf carts will be used again. The fitness center, gym, it's staff only right now, very limited. We said we'll follow the Richardson YMCA, however, they just opened yesterday. So some, you know, this has to be so fluid where you'll have the best intention today and it could change tomorrow. And so, you know, I encourage you to build a system that can move forward and backward easily. We are not don't plan to do any on-site meals or drinks that could be shared. We're encouraging anyone that comes on campus to bring their own when they can come on campus. So step three is pretty much the same. It's just increased to 50 people. Step four is up to 100 people. Step five, over 100, and then the new normal. But we are, our senior pastor has been so supportive of acknowledging that whatever decision that you make, it's going to be too soon for some and too late for others. And just, you know, accepting that and doing the best that you can. It's a lot of information.
Right. So most people are going to need to download that and take a look at it. Are you available for any questions, Lynnita, if they want to email you directly at first?
Yes, absolutely.
All right. Thank you so much for all of that work and showing us the steps. And I did think that, I remember you saying that you also had talked about you might be in step five, but you might want to go back to step four, or that it's fluid, correct?
Yes.
All right, thank you so much. Kay Richardson is gonna come up. She is gonna speak to us. She is from St. Andrew United Methodist Church, and they have been discussing a communication strategy at their church that she's gonna share. Thanks, Kay.
There we go. So, funny story, I'm always teasing Robert Hasley about his technology use. So I know you'll help me keep a secret that I accidentally clicked on his calendar invitation instead of my own today. So I am Kay Richardson, and I'm so happy to be with all of you today. All of these strategies that you've heard the others speak to, we've all been in this together and had the opportunity to share with one another. We are, just as you all are, going through this process, and it seems like it's 2020 and every day we have something new, right? So we are moving along with our plans to reopen. And the first thing that we did was inform our staff, because we understand that they're going to be getting questions from all of those that know them the best in the church. And so we wanted to make sure we gave them the tools they needed to be able to answer as many questions as possible. And of course, they can always refer to pastors and senior leadership for answers if they don't know them. So last week, we informed our staff that this past weekend, our pastors would be making announcements in worship services about our plans to reopen. And they have done that, and we are letting our congregation know all along the way, as you've heard, what is going on with our reopening strategies. And we said at this point, we are going to look at mid-July for reopening. So we let our staff know last week on Thursday. Our pastors made that announcement in worship live in all weekend services this past weekend. And the next step we are doing just happened right before I got on this call. We had a what we call town hall today with our entire staff. and we pulled them into the sanctuary and we practiced on them. We have put tape at the bottom of our pews, right where you would sit down, every 2 feet. And so we had our leadership team be our ushers and greeters today as everyone came in, and we seated them the way that we have worked through on our plans. And then we explained to them the process that we've been going through the last 3 months. We had a leadership task force, we had a medical task force, we met with our trustees twice, we met with our staff parish, and then we ultimately met with our executive committee, who has planned all of our strategies that we've put in place and will be putting into place effective now. So our staff got to hear all of that today, and that was such an important time that we spent with them this morning, so that they felt informed for their own personal selves in knowing the safety precautions we're putting in place for them as well as our congregation. Next week, we will begin to make a series of videos that we will push out in all of our communication platforms. So we will be sending by email a video of our pastors talking about our reopening strategies, when that will be, and what we expect that will look like. We'll also put that on all social media platforms, and it will as well be on the church website so that it's available 24/7. And we will continue to communicate these messages about our reopening every weekend until we get there. One of the things that we think we'll find very valuable is having a preview weekend, and we plan on doing that the weekend before we will actually be able to invite our congregation back. And all those committees I just named to you, we've let them know every step when we've been visiting with them that they're going to be our guests to come in and be our preview audience so that we can practice on them. And some of them might be a little cantankerous when they come to the door and they're asked to put on a mask. And that way our volunteers and our staff will have a little practice by the time we're ready to really begin having our congregation come back in. So that is kind of our process that we've been working through to this point. The week right before we open, after that preview weekend, there'll be another email very detailed where we're setting expectations. This isn't the new normal. We don't want this to be normal. It's just new. And so that's the way we will discuss that with our videos that will be going out in all of our platforms for communication. This is new, and this will be phase one of new. We don't know when phase two will come, but we will continue to communicate that with you. And oh, by the way, as everyone has said, we could go back to having the church have to close down again, depending upon what happens. And so what we have decided to do is communicate to our congregation that we have three sanctuary worship services that we will be reopening. One is on a Saturday evening, and it will have an in-person focus. We will still live stream it like we are now, but the congregation that's there will be our focus. On Sunday morning, it will be more of a live audience type experience, and we are shooting special videos so that when people come in, we will be able to tell them what to expect. There may be some musical pieces that will be filmed, and they will be shown during that service, but they won't be live in the venue with them. And so just as our musicians and our musical staff have been so creative during this process, we hope that that will continue. And that might mean that they'll be seeing some taped pieces. So we're going to communicate all of those type things before people arrive, as well as all of the three major initiatives that we all know are so important. Wear a mask, and that's going to be mandatory. We will require everyone coming in to use hand sanitizer, and we will ask them all to social distance. So our communication strategy is just that we're doing it as often as we can to stay in touch and let people know what our plans are. And I'll just add on to what Kim said. With our sanctuary, we can typically see 1,600. We think we'll be doing good to get about 300. So that kind of gives you an idea of the difference in how much the social distancing is really, it really going to matter. We laugh and say, we hope we have lots of families of six, because we'll be able to get more in instead of lots of individual single people, right? So that is our strategy right now on communication. And just as all of these things, we know it's probably going to change by this time next week.
Thanks so much, Kim. Okay, sorry for offering all that information. I think as we move into the next part of our of what we're offering today, I'd like to talk a little bit about a piece that Don Underwood has done called Keeping the Five Audiences Connected. And this is a little bit of a shout out. We are in the process of getting ready to host him to do a webinar on keeping these five audiences connected. These are the new audiences that have come to be because of COVID-19. So I'm just going to go over these very quickly, but I also want to just invite you to watch for the upcoming webinar that I think he'll be able to do a little more deeply. So there are five audiences that are now a part of our churches: the highly engaged and the unafraid. And those are going to be the ones that come to our houses of worship no matter what decision we make. And when they say it's time to open, they are going to be there at the high opening. So that's the first audience. Our second audience is the highly engaged but cautious. This is that audience that will return more slowly in sputters, and depending on the degree of confidence, they will feel about safety and health, and they'll start returning cautiously. The next group is the highly engaged who will potentially never return or rarely return. And really this audience oftentimes are seniors there, but not entirely. They have good reason to have some anxiety about being out in public. They have experienced the effectiveness of our digital worship experiences. And this may change the way that they engage our facilities in the local church forever. So that group is a very important group. I'll go on to say what the next group is and make a couple more comments. Go back. The next group is the less engaged. And, you know, that's a lot of our membership. They feel a great affection for the church. They call the church, our church, their church. They are not as engaged, and they may have gotten even less engaged during this period of time, that's just one of the realities. And then the last is the newly reached, and it's possible that our online worship services have reached new people and have reinvigorated a less engaged group. And so you know, it's important to remember that these persons now feel very connected. And I think one of the things that when I was listening to Don Underwood speak about this is that we have to really be aware that all of these audiences are very important audiences for us to continue to engage, and that we don't want to make a mistake by leaving some of these groups behind as we think about returning back to our buildings. They are important to the viability of our churches, the financial viability of our churches, the spiritual viability of our churches, and us staying connected to them is absolutely important. So part of what I just wanted you to have a taste of is a piece that he is going to be doing that really talks about keeping engaged with all of these different audiences and continuing to have strong relationships with them so that you will continue to have viability in your churches. So I'm going to stop with that. I know that there are some questions, but we're going to take the questions at the end of the time because I'd like us to move over to our small groups. And my plan is to have the small groups be for about 25 minutes. We have small group leaders that are going to be leading these groups. And you'll have an opportunity to engage each of the topics and share your also your experiences and your knowledge, as well as the leaders are going to help with the content. So thank you all. I think if it'll just take a few minutes, and I'll let Mariel put everybody into groups, we'll begin that particular component. Thank you. Thank you to all the speakers as well. Some questions or in comments, if anybody has something that they'd like to put in the chat, you can go ahead and do that.
Cammy, while they're working on that, some of the ones that came in earlier were questions about contact tracing and letting local officials know, how do we respect HIPAA laws, and let alert possibly exposed individuals, if any of our presenters want to comment on that.
Okay.
So I don't know that we are under any legal obligation to notify anyone if we find out someone who was here had it. It's more of, for us, it's because the person, it's my understanding that when the person's diagnosed, they actually have to reveal everyone they've been in contact with. It's their responsibility. And of course, we can't give any names. I mean, even for staff, if someone on staff was diagnosed, we wouldn't be able to tell the other staff members who it was, right? And they're all going to figure it out, I'm sure. But so we just want to be able to know who was in the building, so that when someone comes to us and says, I need to, you know, give this information, that we were able to do that. We're able to share that information. I mean, I would want to know, you know, if I were exposed, but I have not seen that it is a, you know, legal reporting obligation.
Kim, can you also speak to, I think you said you had waivers that you guys put together. Can you speak?
I just sent a message to Kelly, and I'm going to send the waiver to her as soon as we're done here. And if y'all want to figure out where you want to put that, but I'm happy to share.
Okay.
There's a similar question. I see Andy just answered it again. Kevin Strimke had posted about church liability, and Andy's response is that Jody is working on some of those details. The next slide will be our ntc.org resource page. If you're not already very familiar with it, that's where we put content as soon as we're able to have it and distribute it. So it's a good first place to look for things like that. What does cleaning between services look like? Solutions, types of wipes, vacuuming, is it different than our regular cleaning?
Cam, you wanna speak to that?
Yeah, so for us, it looks like right now it's gonna be our custodial service coming in with, you know, backpacks of whatever spray stuff they decided wouldn't hurt the pews and would dry fastest. I don't know what that is. Our facilities director knows what that solution is. Because, you know, you think, well, it's every other pew. So why don't you just, if you're going to do two services, the pews that are blocked off the first service, you just swap them out. But you can't do that because somebody might have touched, you know, the back of the back of the other pew. So you got to spray everything. That's essentially what we're going to do, is just spray the place down. That's the fastest way to do it. You can't, I mean, the sanctuary our size, you can't wipe it down. It would take forever. And yeah, I don't know what the name of the solution is that we're using, but I can find that out.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions?
I didn't understand the comment that you can't tell the rest of the staff if a member of the staff becomes ill.
You can't give their name.
Why not?
It violates violates HIPAA.
HIPAA requirements.
Yeah.
HIPAA doesn't cover us. It's not a patient. They're not patients. HIPAA only covers medical providers and their patients. It doesn't apply to us.
I'm not gonna tell other staff members that which staff person has COVID. I think that's personal, private information. So
don't you think they deserve to know if they had contact with that staff member?
I'll tell them they had contact with a staff member that has been diagnosed. They don't have to know which one. All they have to know is they've been in contact with a staff member who has been diagnosed.
Okay. I suppose that's your prerogative.
There's a couple of questions coming in the chat. One of them is about different places people have sourced, and we've had that on another call, and I think there's a list. And so if it hasn't been put together, I will try to source that list of places, resources people are finding for cleaning supplies and information about them. And then the next one is any mandatory requirements about closing in-person worship if we find out someone had symptoms or a positive test, and then anyone through a worship service has been exposed.
It's not my understanding you have to close, but you have to clean.
We don't have those requirements listed on our website. We would like for you to use wisdom and your own leadership agency to make the right decision.
I did have a pastor or church leader ask me what if someone does come down with the virus, what would we do? And I said, well, my recommendation would be that you close for 2 weeks. I realize that there's a difference in the population and those kinds of things in the Northwest District. But if one of the churches that had 50 people in worship and one person came down with it, and the way they congregate after church, I would say we need to close down for 2 weeks at least to see if anybody develops it. So I think you're right, Kim. You've got to use your wisdom. But anyway, I know it's hard to close down a church with 1,000 people in worship.
Right. Well, it is time for us to close down. I think we were supposed to end at 3:30. So I'd like to be able to just stop for a minute and say thank you so much to all of our presenters today. Once again, you can go on our website and to our coronavirus resources, and it's also under latest news. You can also, we'll take a minute, you can cut and paste our presentation from today, and that's in our chat at the very beginning, as well as the resources that we used that had the checklist and also the rolling out plan, so that you can use them for your own resources. Thank you all for your faithful leadership. Appreciate so much the work you do at the local church, whether you be a layperson, a pastor, someone on staff. I really appreciate all that you're doing to be faithful at this time. And to our presenters, thank you for the resource that you brought today. You have blessed us, and we appreciate it so much. God bless you all.